Well, hello and welcome to the Marriage and the Family, Kiss Me Like You Mean It. My name is Billy Simmons. For those that don't know me, a little bit about me. I've been married for 37 years. Wife's Libby, two sons and six grandchildren. She's put up with me for that long. That's a blessing from God. I've saved in 1998. I'm a retired naval officer. I spent 26 years in the Navy. Member of Stuart Heights Baptist Church since 2002. I attend the Chattanooga campus, biblical counselor and Sunday school teacher, probably for about 9 years. I have 200 hours of formal training in Indiana on biblical counseling and a lot of hours of informal training, which is sometimes more instructive in the counseling room, right? Our presentation tonight will be high level. It's going to be covering biblical principles and commandments. If you have specific issues or challenges or questions that you would like to talk about, I'm certainly available after the session, or you can set up an appointment and we'll be glad to talk to you at the counseling center. We're not going to use inappropriate modern sexual terms. We are glorifying Christ. Sexual unity, biblical sexual unity, is just as valuable, and it's a gift from God, and God's responsible for it. It's just like talking about communications or finance, and we don't use vulgar language to do that, so we're not going to use vulgar language in here. But we're going to be talking about sex. It is sexuality, right? Biblical sexuality, so we will be talking about sex. And giggling's allowed, and we encourage homework, okay? I remember a couple of years ago I had a class and said the same thing and went through the sessions, and the next week, right in front of everybody in the hall, this young couple runs up, and they were cut-ups anyway, and they run up to me right in front of everybody and said, "Hey, Billy, we did our homework and it was sure fun." And now she's getting ready to have another baby, and he said he's going to drag her into another biblical sexuality class, right? Yeah.
We call that.
That's right, church growth. So yeah, it's intended to be serious but yet lighthearted, and we'll talk about it and try to give God the honor. And that is why we do this. We do this like we do everything, to glorify our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. As you notice, for coming through these sessions, they're addressing different aspects of marriage. And whenever we counsel, we address the different aspects of marriage, communications, finance, raising children, religious growth, and biblical sexual unity. We're going to teach you that biblical sexual unity consists of three core parts of a relationship. It's friendship, meaning being soulmates, you share life together, it's the soul. Deep affection or passion is total commitment to each other, is the heart. And the physical erotic sexual act, which is the body. So it's the soul, the heart, and the body. And that's where a lot of people, the world teaches you that the physical erotic sexual act is probably all there is to it. Well, I guess to be straightforward and quite frankly, you know, dogs do that, right? We're not dogs, we're God's creation. So biblical sexual unity is the soul, the heart, and the body. And we want to educate you on what biblical sexual unity is. You know, what does God say about this? Basically, the MTV, Hugh Hefner didn't create this. God created this, right, and provided it to us as a gift. Certainly nothing impure about it within the confines of marriage. We want to improve your communication so that you'll speak freely about sex, foreplay, orgasms. What I find in counseling is that if couples are able to talk about sex freely, they'll talk about finances, they'll talk about raising kids, they'll talk about anything, right? If you can get over that, you talk about anything. I guess it never ceases to amaze me. I've seen a lot of Christian couples, I wonder how they had kids. Because you'd think they'd never had sex, right? Whenever you ask them about it, you know, it's like, look, we don't talk about that. But we want you to talk about that freely, certainly within the right context, like we're talking about. If you notice, we don't have any children in the room here, right? You know, so there's a time and place for everything. So we want you to talk freely. And we're going to make some practical recommendations for improved sexual unity. And one of the biggest things, and nowadays, what I think, and from talking to people and in counseling, is that both spouses are usually working, and their schedules are usually just chock-a-block full. And they're waiting for this magic moment after mom has been working all day that she's supposed to walk in, and at 5:45 whenever the kids are screaming and everything, all of a sudden, hey honey, let's run and jump in the bed, because it's a spontaneous act, right? And if the husband or she doesn't remember to do that, then all of a sudden we don't love each other, okay? The lesson is, if you fail to plan, you're going to plan to fail, right? If you have a budget, if you plan your budget out every week or two, whatever that budget, whatever your timeline is, you're planning how you're going to spend that budget. Well, why wouldn't you plan how you're going to date your wife, or how you're going to romance or have biblical sexual unity, basically, right? So you plan it, especially nowadays, because everybody's so busy, before you know it, you got a couple of weeks under your belt. And the guy sitting back there saying, not quite there, Billy. But it does happen. It really does. Pretty soon you're attending to everything in the world, and we forget about date night, and we need to plan for that, okay? So we're going to discuss how male-female nature affects sexual unity. There is a difference. We look at things a little different from our female counterparts. And finally, we want to make sure that you don't look like this in the bedroom, right? Does that ever happen? I know not to you two or you guys or whatever, but it happens, right? I mean, you go to bed like that, there looks like there's a lot of biblical sexual unity going on there, right? Huh? They probably already sinned by going to bed mad. That's what that looks like to me. We don't want you to look like that. We want you to look like this couple.
Seems like lately people love to play with fire. And the other games they play are just as bad. I'd rather stay at home and feel your burning lips and play the kind of games that make me glad. Oh, let's chase each other around the room tonight. Let's play the kind of games we played on our wedding night. To lock in both the doors is only right. Honey, let's chase each other around the room tonight.
Skeet and Lulu are available for counseling if you guys. I thought, my son is a video production guy, much like Chris back there, and I said, hey, I need something kind of an icebreaker to clean, but yet something to the point, you know. It's hard to imagine Christian couples running around a room like that, huh? But that's fun. And we're going to talk about that sex is not only for, you know, populating the earth, but also for fun, right? So let's get started, okay, in your handouts. Excuse me. First, we're going to see, we do know that sex is for marriage, right? Sex outside of marriage is adultery and is a sin. No ifs, ands, or buts. Sex is for marriage. So that means we need to wait and not have sex before we get married. Now, you'll have to understand that this is also designed for pre-married couples also, okay? So some of this will be addressing the prior to marriage rather than for those of you that are already married. So we're asking why you should wait. Well, should wait because of Scripture. If you look at the top of your handouts, you see 1 Corinthians 7 where it says, nevertheless, because of sexual immorality, let each man have his own wife and let each woman have her own husband. If you'll notice, Paul didn't say go for it outside of marriage, did he? He said have your own husband and your own wife. So we should wait because of Scripture and also because of our spouse, right? Now what happens whenever we don't wait? There's shame involved and there's guilt involved. Repentance needs to happen. It is a big deal if you had sex outside of marriage before you were married, whether with each other or whether with somebody else, because that is sin that needs to be repented. And what happens is we see lots of times this sin is brought into the bedroom. An example is I had a counselee one time that in college, she basically was a marathon sex person and she thought it was a lot of fun. And after she graduated from college, she found the Lord Jesus and she repented. Well, she got married, and then whenever they would be in the bedroom, she really turned into an iceberg because She just didn't want to do anything that was that horrible that she did before. What she was doing was bringing the worldly sin into a sacred bedroom situation. So that's why if you haven't repented, you need to repent to the Lord Jesus and also to each other, and that way it's clear, right? And you don't have a problem with that. Now, we know we wait, but while we wait, what should we be doing, right? Well, we need to prepare ourselves for marriage. Need to be a person of conviction, and this applies to you even if you already are married. You need to be a person of conviction as well as a person of commitment, right? If you look on your handout, you'll see 1 John 2:15-16 says, "Do not love the world or the things in the world. For all of this is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. It's not of the Father, but is of the world." We need to be convicted and need to be committed to the sacred institution of marriage and what it stands for, and understand that that reflects Christ's relationship with the church. And what does He want us to do? He wants us, our marriages, to reflect His relationship with the church. Because remember, if we're pushing that glory up to Christ, what comes down? Blessings come down, right? And that's what we want to be doing, is glorifying Him. So we know we prepare for it. We also need to plan for getting married. And one of the key elements there is we only date a Christian, and we certainly only marry a Christian. So we see Corinthians talks about that 6:14, don't be unequally yoked together with unbelievers. It's very sad whenever you have a married couple and one is a believer and the other is a non-believer, and one wants to really serve the Lord and the other one could care less. It's a formula for divorce, basically, or a lot of misery, if you will. So we know sex is for marriage, right? And sex is between a man and a woman. I never thought that I would see where that was being challenged, but that's being challenged in our culture today, isn't it? Right? And God gave us this gift, and He specifically stated it was between a man and a woman. It said Genesis 1:27-28 states, "So God created man in His own image. In the image of God He created him. Male and female He created him," right? It's Adam and Eve in the garden. It wasn't Adam and Eddie. It was, you know, male and female. And so why did He give us sex between a man and a woman? Well, it's for procreation. It was to populate the earth. It was His plan to fill the earth. Now, anytime God has a plan, who's there to attack that plan? It's usually Satan, right? So what's the attack on God to fill the earth? What's the first thing that comes to mind? Be abortion, wouldn't it? Right? That's the taking of innocent life, killing them little unborn babies. That's straight from the pits of hell. And also, homosexuality is an abomination. So God blessed them. If you look at 28, Genesis 1:28, God blessed them, and God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and subdue it." So God gave sex between a man and a woman for procreation. It was a way to populate the earth, but we see that that was His plan, but we see there's an attack on it, and it's been ongoing, and it seems to be increasing at this point in time. Now, not only was sex between a man and a woman this gift from God given to us for procreation, but this is usually where I get a standing ovation from all the guys, and whenever we have a lot more in here, Jim, you can stand up if you want to, it's okay. For recreation, right? It's fun. I don't get like one amen out of that from one of the guys. Come on. Amen. Yeah, okay. It's okay for the ladies to say that too. We don't look down on it in Christians. You know, it's all right for women, Christian women, to have fun with sex. You know that, right? You guys with me on that? Okay. I told you we're going to say the S-E-X word in here, okay, several times. Okay. So it's for recreation, right? Yeehaw. And it was God's ideal. It is God's gift, not Hugh Hefner. Not MTV, not current culture, not the world. It was God's ideal. Okay, we know sex is for marriage. It's between a man and a woman, right? And it's the merger of two into one. Your handouts again, if you look at Genesis 2:23-24, it says, "And Adam said, 'This is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and they shall become one flesh.'" Okay, so it's the merger of two into one. Remember, we're merging the mind, the soul, right, the heart, and the body. Or as I tell people, the body part is the reward for a job well done, right? Remember, the important lesson here, especially for the guys, because the way we're natured, you make love to the mind and the soul first before you go making love to the body, right? And you'll find out, if you've been married long enough, that unless you do that, making love to the body usually slows down a lot, right? It just don't happen, and we'll see why that in just a moment here, okay? So we see with this, we have the deep intimacy of sex, and that's what God was talking about specifically whenever he says, hey, therefore a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. So what is he saying, they shall become one flesh? What does that mean? That's question time, it's not rhetorical. What does that mean? They're having sex, right? It's the physical body act of having sex, right? Okay, so it's the deep intimacy of sex, but because we're under the curse, we always have the dirty side of the house too, the curse side, the evil side, right? So we see the dirty intimacy of sex. So the deep intimacy of sex that we read in Scripture is the godly way, right? It's the biblical sexual unity, right? The dirty intimacy of sex is the worldly view of it. And we see that in the form of fornication. And adultery. Remember, sex outside of marriage is adultery. Okay? So, we've seen sex is for marriage. We need to prepare ourselves, plans between a man and a woman, procreation and yeehaw for recreation. It's the merger of two into one. We know there's a real pure, godly intimacy of sex, but there's also worldly or dirty intimacy of sex. So now let's talk about sexual fulfillment. What are the roles and what does the Bible have to say about this? We find a lot of confusion among couples, at least I do, and I'm sure the other counselors do. Whenever you're talking to them, a lot of Christian couples just don't understand their roles. They don't understand what God expects out of them in terms of biblical sexual unity. So we're going to talk about that a little bit. And we see that a critical dimension of the marital covenant is sexual fulfillment. Verse 3, 1 Corinthians 7, top of your handout. I'm saying it's on their handout. Is this on their handout also? Okay, at the top of your handout, it says, let the husband render to his wife the affection due her, and likewise also the wife to her husband. So this is not a recommendation, this is a command, right? Let the husband render to his wife the affection due her, and likewise also the wife to her husband. See, we're already having some men back there. He's already got his arm around her back there. That's good, man. Yeah. Okay, now, God considers sexual fulfillment to our spouse to be our marital duty, right? It's not a recommendation. There's nowhere in the Bible that says, hey, we just kind of think about it. Study on it a while. It's a commandment. It's our marital duty. As a matter of fact, Bible translates it in a different way depending on which Bible translation you're reading, but the NIV translates it marital duty. The New King James Version, affection due. The ESV's conjugal rights, and the King James Version is due benevolence. The actual translation, I always like this one, is to pay what you owe. Now, here's where it gets fun. You guys need to look each other in the eyeballs, okay? Come on now, you're married. Just stare each other in the eyes. I'm being serious. Look each other in the eyes, you know, real serious. There you go. Jim, careful, Jim. You're old now. Come on now, in the eyeballs, you got to look each other in the eyes. This is what makes this good, okay? Really, can you? You can do this, okay? Look in the eyes, okay? Like that. Remember whenever you got married? Who remembers got married? It was like, you know? Okay, the wives, you need to look at your husband and repeat after me. You owe me sex. Okay? Now, husbands, look your wife straight in the eye and say, yep, I'm going to pay what is due. You guys did pretty good. I think you might get a passing grade, and you guys might be eligible for homework tonight, okay? But that's the actual translation. That's what it means. We pay what we owe. God is not, it's not a recommendation. It's a commandment. He says, hey, look, you owe each other sexual fulfillment, right? Now, having said that, the sexual needs are given, both mates are given equal value. And where that the world gets involved here sometimes is that it tells us that, you know, the wife is not to be a sex slave. I mean, the world tells us that the wife should be a sex slave. And as a matter of fact, the world tries to put out there that that's the only value derived from females is just how sexy they are. And, you know, are they very active? And indeed, high school girls are having a terrible time now, middle school also, and probably down to elementary, because they're being pressured to have sex, right? That's who they are. So that's where we come in as a church to try to combat that. But the wife, that doesn't mean that the wife has to be a sexual slave. But before you wives start giggling a lot, it doesn't mean, you know, that the husband has to show self-control for a long, 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 long time. If the husband wants sex more than once every 2 months, it doesn't mean he's a pervert, okay? So the wife doesn't need to be a sex slave, and the husband doesn't need to show control for a long, long time. What it does mean is that sexual desires are normal. God built sexual desire in us within the confines of marriage. Within the framework of marriage, sexual desires are pure and holy. Okay, they're normal. Now, there is a little bit of difference between men and women, and some of you may have heard this before. But, you know, men are like microwaves, and I always got a lot of different comments out of that whenever I have a larger class, and I know probably what the wives in here are thinking right now, but I won't challenge you for that. But essentially, men, they can be ready, they can be warmed up in a couple of minutes, you know. I know personally my wife can be in the backyard working all day, sweating up a storm, all gritty, grimy, dirty, and the flower garden or whatever, and it doesn't matter. She can walk in the kitchen, and it's like it's go time, you know. I mean, that's a good-looking woman there, you know? And she looks at me like I'm crazy, right? Why? Because women are different, aren't we, right? You know, aren't you? Women are a little different. Guys are like microwaves. We can get turned on in a dime, right? Basically in a minute or two. But women are like crock pots, right? Takes all day to cook that food. I mean, you need the guys. You start to romance early, right? Now, romance ought to be an everyday thing or whatever. But whenever you're planning this date night, and it's a Friday night or a Saturday night or maybe Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday night, whatever, you start the romance early. Remember, you make love to the mind, and that pertains to the wives as well as the guys, but it seems like the guys have a harder time with this, you know, because we're just guys. But make love to the mind and the soul, and then that will culminate in a reward for a job well done. Remember, they're crock pots. They need to be, it needs to heat, needs to turn up gradually during the day. And I thought that was a pretty good analogy myself. Okay, sexual desires are normal and they should be fulfilled. Let's look at verse 5. It says, do not deprive one another except with consent for a time that you may give yourselves to fasting and prayer and come together again so that Satan does not tempt you because of your lack of self-control. Is it a difficult world out there now in terms of sexual temptation? How many people have walked through the Bilo line lately or you know, unless you're dead or blind, right? I mean, you've got it all over the place. How about how many surf through the TV tonight? It's almost risky to surf through TV. I'd be especially careful if you got kids because you never know what you're going to run across, right? But there's a lot of temptation there. And remember, is it a sin to be tempted? It's not a sin to be tempted. It's what you do with it. But you can be overcome with temptation, right? And so that's what Paul is talking about. He said, look, don't deprive each other of sex for an extended period of time unless it's for the glory of God and it's mutually agreed upon. Here at Stewart Heights, I've talked with the senior pastor or whatever. We think that if you're, generally speaking, if you're physically able, unless there's complete agreement, that you ought to be having sex at least every 4 or 5 days. The reason you say, now that's a general assessment. There's some people that go much longer. It depends on health, depends on, you know, schedules, depends on if both parties are happy with it. But there's a lot of temptation out there and sexual tension does build up. So you need to keep that in mind. It's not a suggestion, it's a command from God. Sexual desires need to be fulfilled, right? Now there's a little bit of advice here. Man, you gotta slow down some. I mean, you don't have to go forever, but you need to recognize the nature of your spouse, of your mate, that, hey, she is like a crock pot, you know, she needs to be romanced. That's just practical advice. But on the other side of the coin, women, you need to speed up some, you know? I mean, this can go on and on and on forever, and just because you guys start getting in the mood at 7 at night, he shouldn't have to romance you to 6 in the morning, you know? He'll be a little tired by then. So you know where I'm going with this, you know, kind of, and again, it's, what does all this get back to? We talk about this and we talk about, I'm putting all this information out, but really, how do you know what your mate, what your spouse, how do you know how to please your spouse sexually? You gotta talk, right? Usually it's talk, it's communication, right? How do you know what kind of budget to have, what to prioritize on your expenses? Do you talk? If you don't, you should, right? It's the same thing in biblical sexual unity. Communications is the key, right? So that you know, so that you work this out and you have harmony in your family, which brings glory to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So, men, slow down a little bit. Women, speed up a little bit. Understand, he is like a microwave, and whenever he starts blinking and he starts winking, probably he would be rocking and rolling in 2 minutes if you allowed it, okay? So, you know, to make him wait 8 hours is probably torture. Okay? Under normal circumstances. Now, what do you think? Are we straightforward enough in here, or do I need to get more straightforward? Okay. Any sexual fast must meet three requirements, and Paul addressed that. He says, hey, unless you're going to give yourselves to fasting and prayer. So let's look at the three requirements. Again, we're going back to verse 5. It says you may give yourselves to fasting and prayer. Okay, number one should be a mutual agreement. So what happens if let's say your normal sexual routine is twice a week or whatever, and all of a sudden hubby says, hey, I want to fast for 4 days. I want to fast for a week for just to praise God or glorify God or whatever. And the wife says, no, I really wouldn't want to do that. What do you do? You don't fast, right? It says mutual agreement, right? Now, you would talk about that because you'd want to see why or whatever, or maybe meet, you know, compromise. The point of it is, you got to remember, as 1 Peter says, the devil is circling and he wants nothing better than your marriage. And where does he get your marriage at first? Finances usually, right? And sex. What happens whenever things are rough around the house? What usually happens? Whenever it's really tense, what happens? Sex usually dries up, doesn't it? It starts being used as a weapon, right? Now, guys probably don't withhold sex as a weapon typically. There may be some that do, but most don't, right? What do the women do, though? Most of the time, right? It becomes a weapon. Be careful and don't go there, okay? Now, guys, there's a lesson there, too. If you're not being reasonable or whatever, remember, you know, you make love to the heart and the mind, and then the body is a reward for a job well done, right? So you just have to keep that in mind. And again, all of this is about communications, right? It's all about communications. Okay, so it must be mutual agreement, and it must be for spiritual reasons. So, well, I want to fast for a while because, I don't know, maybe the game's on tonight or something. Maybe it's the ACC basketball conference, and that conflicts with whenever you and I typically have sex, so I will fast for this week. No, right? What Paul is trying to do is prevent the devil from getting a stronghold in your relationship. That's what Paul is trying to do. God has given us a way to, he is defining roles, isn't he? Right? Very clear as to what our roles are. And again, it should be for a short time. And again, talking to Pastor Gary, no longer than 4 or 5 days under normal circumstances, with the caveats that I added before, right? Now, what tops all of this? Is there not, I mean, what if, I mean, we know, you know, the wife owns the husband's body and the husband owns the wife's body, and it's her duty to provide sex and it's his duty to provide sex to his wife. What tops all of this above sexual pleasure? It's a commandment, so what would usurp that? What if one of you's sick? Right? Is agape not more important than that? Right? Is your well-being, you know, your common good? Right? What do you think Jesus would expect? Say, nope. Doesn't matter if she's got emphysema, you know, don't matter if she can't breathe, you know, doesn't matter if she's got pneumonia, thou must have sex. Well, some guys go that route, you know, they try to be very autocratic. Now, the Lord says that you're to submit to me, you know, well, they're not to be sex slaves, are they? Uh-uh, you know, right? With me? It's about the common good, and I submit to you that if you're more concerned about your spouse than you are yourselves, then you're going to find that balance. And that's what it takes. That's called being equally yoked in terms of your sacrifice for the Lord, right, in order to glorify the Lord. But usually that doesn't happen, and usually people will take a rain check, you know. So, okay, and here's probably the biggest, if you leave here with nothing else, we're moving a little ahead of time because usually I got a bigger crowd and there's a lot more interaction and stuff, so it takes a little longer for me to run my mouth and get all the points across. You know, I'm really not a talkative guy. I'm usually very quiet all the time. Huh, Jim? What do you think? Huh? Yeah? Yeah, maybe. Maybe not.
I haven't seen that side of it.
You just haven't seen that yet. Okay. Here's the, if you leave with nothing else pertaining to sexual fulfillment, tuck this away. Violation of fulfilling the sexual needs of a partner can lead to unfaithfulness. I think anybody can tell you, there's never, ever, ever any excuse for being unfaithful to a spouse. Never. And Jesus addresses that. But I can almost, I mean, in my experience, and I think the other counselors would probably agree, it's usually never, ever, ever one's fault. Most of the time, people don't wake up in the morning saying, gosh, I just think I'll go out and have an affair today, you know? Or there's always underlying causes or somebody's using sex as a weapon. They're withholding sex, and there's a lot of sexual tension being built up, and there's bitterness that comes about, and then all of a sudden, the spouse will start becoming interested, and they start looking. And there's usually once you can pull that string all the way back to the beginning, you can find that it usually started out with some sort of bitterness over something else. Sex become a weapon. The wife quit fulfilling the male's sexual needs, or vice versa. I've seen both sides. And then what happens? You're a sitting duck for Satan, right? Because if you know where you're having problems in your family, who else knows it as well, if not better than you? Satan, right? And where does he go? He goes for the weak spot in the dam, right? He goes for the crack in the dam. That's where he's going. And what's the most vulnerable spot that usually people have? Sex and money, right? That's usually where it hits at, okay? So don't get caught short of not fulfilling the sexual needs of your spouse, because it can, no, everybody sitting in here could become a victim of that, or could become, it's not really, you can call it a victim, it's a conscious choice, but all of us could be subject to that. Why? Because we all have inherently filthy hearts, don't we? You know, it's like Christ tells us, you know, it's what Paul tells us, you know, we're as filthy rags, and we just can't sit on our pious stool and think, well, this will never ever happen to me. Well, yes, it can happen to us if we're not guarding our hearts, right? Because you let that bitterness start rising, and you let the devil into your marriage relationship anywhere, and this is something that can result, because it's one of the first things that happens is the sex dries up. Whenever a couple comes into my counseling session, I will find that out within the first 30 minutes whether they're having sex or not. If they're having regular sex, then we got a good basis to work on, because it's not completely destroyed yet. But if they're not, that is a real warning light on the dashboard that you got some serious problems. Why? Because God planted that desire in our heart, didn't he? He planted the desire in our heart to have sex for procreation and recreation. And if we've got our spouse there, and all of a sudden we're not having sex, then we've got a serious issue, don't we? There's something serious going on there. We're going to talk about the Bible book on marriage. Does... Okay, who wrote the Book of Love? Song of Solomon, right? Song of Solomon. Yeah, a lot of folks, whenever they come into this particular session, they are they appear to be a bit surprised, you know, that God meant for us to not only, you know, this is a holy matter that we talk about, but do you think that Jesus sat around and never joked? I just can't imagine that he was serious all the time. I think he had a good time with those disciples, and they, you know, just enjoyed each other in the fellowship. So that's what we try to do, is be respectful in truth and in love, but make it a little bit lighthearted. Number one, so people will relax. This is not a topic that some folks have a very difficult time processing this. It doesn't seem to be the problem in here. Okay, so the Song of Solomon, right, is the book of love, correct? Okay, are you guys ready to copy? Okay, so it is the handbook on marriage. God created the institution of marriage, not secular man, right? And the Song of Solomon is the handbook on marriage, and it talks about, it's the art of attraction, talks about the art of dating, provides that counsel. It addresses the art of courtship. You guys didn't know that you did all of that, huh, before you got married? Addresses the art of intimacy. Song of Solomon is, if they don't think that God created sex and intimacy, folks haven't read the Song of Solomon. He's pretty explicit. The art of conflict, the art of romance. Are you guys remotely close to having all them blanks yet? Are you keeping up? Am I too fast? Okay. And the art of commitment. All of that's addressed in the Song of Solomon. So we know it's the handbook of marriage and addresses these different facets of a relationship, right? So now let's look at the language of the book. What if it was written in modern vernacular? It'd be pretty vulgar, wouldn't it? We could bring out some scripture, and if you replace the words with modern vernacular, it'd be really, really vulgar. Be dated. It wouldn't fit necessarily. If it was written in medical or technical terms, it'd be pretty awkward, wouldn't it? If you don't think it'd be awkward, the next time that you're having a romantic moment with your spouse, just lay out some medical or technical terms there and see what that does for the moment. Unless, of course, we got any surgeons in here. I mean, you know. Joke, guys. That was a joke, okay? Okay. It'd be awkward. It'd be academic. Well, it wasn't written in modern vernacular or medical or technical terms. It was written in poetry. And why was it written in poetry? Because it's the language of the lovers. And it's open for interpretation. There's a lot of room for interpretation in some of the verses in the Song of Solomon. So we know it's a handbook on marriage. We've looked at the language of the book. We know that it's written in poetry because poetry is the language of lovers, and it's open for interpretation. So now let's look at the book a little bit, okay? There's some insights to the book that we want to take a peek at. Now we're getting to the point for the title of the session, Kiss Me Like You Mean It. I told you tonight's going to be much more fun than the previous night. Everybody's saying, oh no, here we go. We're going to talk about kissing. Well, the book talks about kissing. And it's interesting, I did a little research on that. There's some clever sayings about kissing, what people have stated about it. It said, demand is always higher than supply. Is that true in your marriage? Shouldn't be. Always higher than supply. You guys ought to be willing to swap spit anytime with your spouse, right? It's the shortest distance between two lips. I thought it was funny. An interchange of salivary bacteria, is that how you pronounce that? Salivary bacteria. And here was one that I really thought kind of struck a chord with me. It's a reaction of the interaction of two hearts, right? That's really what that should be, is the reaction to the interaction of two hearts, of two souls, right? Of two Christian spouses that are together, that should be the natural reaction whenever we see each other. Which is more pleasurable whenever a spouse comes home from work, as soon as they walk through the door? Honey, can you empty the trash? Or I'm glad to see you, and a little smack on the lips, huh? Which one means more? I don't know about you guys, but I like having to empty the trash. Whenever I walk in, I just love to hear that. You know? It's a reaction of the interaction of two hearts. Okay. Now we look at kissing, and good kissing is addressed in the Song of Solomon. You can see some chapters and verses there. Does anybody know what good kissing looks like? Anybody want to demonstrate? Well, hey, you're married. It's okay. We're all friends in here, you know. I bet if this was your wedding, you'd kiss the bride, wouldn't you? Huh? Okay. So, are you guessing whether I'm going to show you what good kissing looks like? Is that a question, right? Yeah, you knew it was coming, right? But you're not expecting this, are you? I'm a little partial to sailors, having been one for 26 years. That was a great picture. Remember that? Awesome picture, but it gets better, right? Is that a good kiss or what? Hubbies, have you ever did your wife that way? Have you ever got the leg raised up like that? Have you, Jim? Go ahead, Peggy, be honest. Have you?
It's been a few years since I've been there.
Well, now you'd have to have like a support or something like that. Only because you're weak, not because there's any additional weight there, right?
No.
Well, you guys, okay, share with the class, Sonia. You need to share with the class. Oh, don't be embarrassed, hon. It gets better, trust me. Okay, so you think this is good kissing? Let me show you some real kissing, right? This is for those of you that need a little tutoring. There's the leg lift. By the way, this is approved by our senior pastor at Stuart Heights Baptist Church. Now, that's what kissing looks like, right? I can't remember if it plays again if I click. No, we got away with it, okay. So we see sex is for marriage, and we've looked at what good kissing looks like. That was no charge for that, by the way. We just threw that in there. Song of Solomon also talks about sex is for marriage, and it quotes, one of the quotes out of there, it says, "Do not stir up nor awaken love until it pleases." Love in a Christian relationship that he's talking about should be within the confines of a marriage. That's what he's talking about. That's in chapter 2, verse 7, 3, and 5, and chapter 8, verse 4 is where you can find that. And it also talks about, whenever it's talking about little foxes, it's talking about problems. And this is very high level. I'd encourage you, this is a good Bible study. And it also talks about all night long. Said Solomon was a great lover. Of course, he was the king, so he didn't have to get up and go to work at 5 in the morning, did he? And then he also says God speaks in the Song of Solomon. He says, "Eat, O friends, drink, yes, drink deeply, O beloved ones." What he is telling married couples is to enjoy sex. It's not just for procreation. Remember, it is the culmination, right? The physical part of sex, the becoming one flesh, is the final. There's three parts to it, right? There's the mind, the heart, the soul. That's four, but mind, soul, heart, soul, and the physical body. And that's part of biblical sexual unity. Although that makes up biblical sexual unity, what's culture necessarily, which part of that do they necessarily go for? What are we experiencing today? It's just the physical, right? That's what they're teaching, and that's what they're placing great emphasis on, and they're missing it. So we don't really think that they get it at all. So Song of Solomon is the handbook on marriage, right? It's the language of the book. It's written in what? Poetry, right? And it talks about kissing, reinforces the ideal that sex is for marriage. It was talking about that even before Paul started talking about it in the New Testament, right? Talks about it, addresses problems, all those things. Remember the art of attraction, dating, courtship, intimacy? Song of Solomon talks about all of that. So sex was God's idea, wasn't it, huh? He's the one that invented this. It's the mingling of the souls. That's what biblical sexuality is the mingling of the souls. So just remember what we're supposed to do in our marriages. But biblical sexuality is one aspect of the marriage. It's not the main part, but it's very important. It's just as important as finances or anything else into a good marital relationship. But just remember, our marriages are supposed to reflect Christ's relationship with the church. It's supposed to look godly so that whenever people not only see us, but see our marriage, there's supposed to be something different about us. We're supposed to reflect Christ's relationship with His people, with His children. So I would encourage you, if you haven't, to read Song of Solomon and spend time and do a Bible study in Song of Solomon. Don't run away from it. If they are, periodically they'll offer that here. It's been a few years, but if you either online, I'd encourage you to do that. It's a neat study. And it really does, and I think counselors will agree with me or whatever, in counseling, that is definitely a warning light on the dashboard if there's a lack of biblical sexuality. If there's a lack of sex in the marriage, that is a real sign that there's trouble in the marriage under normal circumstances. Obviously, there's physical issues and stuff, but even then, it can still indicate that that can be a problem, right? So, hopefully you've enjoyed this. Hopefully it was done with taste and brought glory to our Lord and Savior and had a pretty good time to break the ice, you know. And all I can say is that I encourage you to do all the homework you can do. Okay? Thank you.